Yes, good. Welcome, and let's give another round of applause to these fabulous musicians.
Thank you.
They follow Kim around to all her book launches. It's lovely.
She follows us around.
So welcome. My name is Heather Campbell. I am the publisher for Latitude 46 Publishing and delighted to be publishing Kim Fahner's debut novel. And we're here to celebrate her accomplishment and her branching out from poetry and creative nonfiction to do fiction. And I think you will love this book. It is so many wonderful things about it. And I'll let you read it and learn for yourself. So a few housekeeping things. Thanks to Knox Hall for having us here this evening. Washrooms are downstairs and so are refreshments. So after the conversation we have here and the singing and the music, Kim will be signing copies of her book up here afterwards, and you're welcome to grab refreshments downstairs as you wait, because I think there'll be a lineup. So let me not take any more of the time dedicated to this celebration and introduce you to the accomplishments of Kim Fahner. Many of you know her, but she is being recognized all the time for her work. So Kim is the author of 5 books and 2 chapbooks of poetry, and now The Donoghue Girl. It's her debut novel. She is recently named as a finalist in the 2023 Ralph Gustafson Poetry Contest and won 2nd place in Prairie Fire's 2023 McNally Robinson Bookseller Creative Nonfiction Contest. She's just been named as one of 15 finalists in the Fiddleheads Creative Nonfiction Contest for her essay, I'll Be Singing. And we'll be hearing her singing tonight, too. Kim is the first vice chair of the Writers Union of Canada, a member of the League of Canadian Poets, and a supporting member of the Playwrights Guild of Canada. She was poet laureate of Sudbury from 2016 to 18, and her next book of poems, The Pollination Field, will be published by Turnstone Press in spring 2025. How do you keep up? I don't know. And I'm just going to introduce Judi Straughan, who is, many of you also know Judi, who is going to have a conversation with Kim about the book. So Judi Straughan is a passionate Kim Fahner fan and is delighted to be joining her on stage tonight. She is a dedicated board member of Jazz Sudbury and the Sudbury Arts Council, under whose umbrella she writes a bi-monthly arts column for the Sudbury Star. 2 good things came out of COVID for Judi. She hosted the Arts at 9 combined podcast, radio show, and television show focusing on all aspects of arts in our region. And secondly, it was the perfect time to do research for the book she co-wrote, A Theater in 5 Acts, 50 Years of Sudbury Theater Center. She's in the 8th season of Adventures on her Eastlink community television show. Judi has been part of CFUW Rebel Book Club for over 25 years and loves to read and debate books. She thanks Kim and Heather for allowing her to be part of tonight's discussion. Please welcome, firstly, Kim Fahner.
Thanks for coming, everybody. I'm going to start with a song with Pat that's in the novel, actually. It's a lullaby for a little person. If you listen carefully to this song, though, it's quite depressing. And then, of course, people who listen to Irish music and sing it will know that all Irish music has some kind of depressing tone to it. So there's tragedy and there's joy, and they're mixed together in Ireland. So, okay. Hope I'm in the right key. On the wings of... Okay, you got to do it again. Sing it with me.
On wings of the
wind or... dark rolling deep. Angels are coming to watch over thee. Angels are coming to watch o'er thy sleep. So list to the wind coming over the sea. Hear the wind blow, love. Hear the wind blow. Now we're going to start.
It is a go. Welcome, everyone, to this portion of the show, and welcome to those who are in the streaming audience. We are streaming to thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people here tonight. I'm convinced. And we may even be showing this on Eastlink Television later on this month under the podium television, so we'll have to see if that happens. Kim Fahner.
Judi Straughan.
We are here. The night has arrived. This is a big deal.
It's a long time coming, yeah.
10 years.
Yeah, from the beginning of it to now.
10 whole years,
yeah.
And your child has been born.
Well,
that's kind
my
of
my paper child.
It is kind
the
of
only
what it
child
feels
I'm
like.
Aware of.
It's kind of how it feels because now you're putting it out into the world.
Yes, yeah.
And you have chosen this particular place.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about why you wanted your book launch here.
Well, I met Leanna Bacon. I don't know where she is. I can't see her anywhere. She's somewhere in here. Where is she? Downstairs.
Downstairs.
That's fine. She'll just not hear this.
Getting you your drinks, because you can drink up here, right?
We were on the market board together back in 2019, 2020 or so, and mm-hmm. we just kind of hit it off, and we've stayed very good friends. And when she started opening Books and Beans and The Night Owl, she's also, along with her partner Dan Guimet, the two of them are the wonder people behind those three places, including Knox Hall. And this, so they're dear friends, and I thought it would be nice to have a literary event to get people who might not have been in here before to see how beautiful it is. But also, the church plays a role, the Catholic Church plays a role, so I thought historically it suited the story and the time period. So thanks to Leanna and Dan for letting us be here this evening. It's really a gift.
So tonight you're going to feel like I haven't even read the book. And that's going to be deliberate because Kim gave me the book in July. It is an absolute delight to read. You are going to love it. I didn't know one single solitary thing about the book. She handed it to me and I had, oh, the tension, the discoveries, the secrets, what happens next. I was able to take that journey and just keep flipping and flipping and reading. So I want to make sure that somehow I don't tip you off on too much about what's going to happen in the book, because I want you to have the same enjoyment I did. So we will both be cagey.
To try.
We will try to be cagey. How would you, when someone says, so what's the story? What's it about? How do you distill that into a couple of sentences? It is a story about
family, and I guess about the complexities of family relationships and romantic relationships, and how dysfunctional both of those things can be. While they seem to be functional on the surface, secrets and things that are lived and then not kept as secrets, but we just weren't around to see them or hear them. Privacy, oppression by way of Catholicism and Irishry. I love my Irish heritage, but it can be very, with the Catholicism, very oppressive and patriarchal. So this is about a young woman named Lizzie Donoghue who balks against that oppression, and that's the story. The entire thing is Lizzie's story.
Well, it's interesting too that you set it in a mining environment, and that's one of the things that's going to delight you so much. If you live in Sudbury, if you know Sudbury, you're going to be delighted with the settings because we're familiar with them. But just when you're describing that story, there are things that happen on the surface of your story, and then you mine. Everything goes so deep. It all comes together, this mining setting that you have chosen. Did you deliberately choose the mining setting, or was it because of the springboard into this story that it had to be where it was?
Well, it's based on a family story that I heard. Some relatives in my family who are here will say it maybe wasn't true. But I guess that's how families work, right? You hear one story from one person and another story from another story person. When I was working on this novel in 2016 at Banff with Lawrence Hill, he said to me when he read part of it, he said, you're nervous about this because it's partially based on a family story set in a small town that no longer exists outside your hometown. That's a lot of weight and responsibility to carry. But he said, mine your stories. So when you talk about the mining metaphor, that is in all of my work, whether in plays, creative nonfiction, or poetry, or in this piece, to do with what you see on the surface and then what's hidden underneath and needs to be revealed metaphorically.
but it is based on my mother's family, the Kelly family. So if you've read some of the articles that are out lately this week, my great-grandfather was James Cornelius Kelly, and he was the first recorded merchant in Creighton in 1908. Before that, he ran the Hudson's Bay store here in Sudbury, and after he retired from Creighton, he moved into Sudbury proper. So my great-aunts, the Kelly girls, we used to call them the girls, some parts of the family called them the aunts, used to tell us stories around the kitchen table about Creighton, and my grandmother did as well, and it was just sort of like a marinating through my storytelling genes. And I got it from those women, so it didn't come from my dad's side, although my dad would probably be really annoyed to hear me say that. But he's dead, so he's still here, so he will still be annoyed to hear it.
Writers like Mary Lawson and Alice Munro think that the small town is the place to set stories. Did you find this served you really well? I mean, it was in Creighton, and it's going to be in Creighton because it's your family, but mm-hmm. does the small town serve you as a writer?
You mentioned Lawson and Munro, but I would mention Shields and then Urquhart do mm-hmm. the same thing True. With Canadian literature and for place and for women writers and women protagonists. So I always think of Jane Austen in terms of how Jane Austen's stories are rooted in particulars, social conventions, and observing those behaviors with people and relationships. And I think that's been around since the beginning of time, even in Shakespeare and before Shakespeare. So yeah, I think in our particulars, we find our universals as humans. Does that make sense?
It makes sense.
Okay.
Funny that you mentioned Jane Austen. Because I think when you're reading the book, you're going to say, is that one of your favorite writers? Because I had, yes, because yes. you will feel this Jane Austen overtone in the book. And it's wonderful.
That's like a huge compliment.
Well, but it's true. I couldn't help but think of Jane Austen. And when you get names like Emma in the book that are used, or you get Elizabeth that are used, these are
older.
But even without using those names, I feel the Jane Austen touch. So yes, it is a compliment for sure.
Thanks.
Graham Norton, who you might know as a
Graham Norton. Why didn't you tell me you were going to talk about Graham Norton?
I didn't know I was until this morning.
I watch him on YouTube all the time.
I was listening to a podcast this morning. I didn't even realize that Graham Norton was a writer besides. I just thought he was a comic interviewer.
And he's Irish.
And that's
people
right.
People think he's British.
That's
and they're
right.
wrong.
He's Irish. And what he said was that all Irish stories are escape stories. What do you think? Have you written an Irish story here? Is it an escape one or not?
Well, she's definitely trying to escape her life, and so she finds this young man who she thinks will be the route to escape, and dreams of escaping the town and the country and exploring because she's a big reader. So maybe she's a bit like Emma, So I think there's a bit of escape in every story. We wouldn't write books, writers, and we wouldn't read as readers if we didn't want to escape. Right? Fiction's great for escaping. Mm-hmm. Your world can be crumbling and you pick up a book and you can forget about mm-hmm. the fact that somebody's treated you poorly or your turtle got run over or whatever it mm-hmm. is, right?
Within the confines of this family, and it is, as Kim says, it's very much a family story. It's a very complex family. Mm-hmm. It seems to me almost everyone in that family wants to escape. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that this is this our families, is there ever a happy family that everyone wants to stay together forever and ever? Your family seems to want to, in this book, you're, she's saying to your relatives, I'm sorry, no, it's fiction, okay? It's fiction. She wants
now
you to
I'm
know.
Now I'm going to pass out, I'll just have some water. Ask me the question again.
Well, I'm just, this is not a dysfunctional family, it actually functions. It actually functions, but it functions with such tension and the need to escape. Is this a richer writing environment than happiness? Like, is dissatisfaction a more fertile field for you?
Gosh, there's like two questions in there. First of all, you should know it's not autobiographical to my family. There's a family rumor that two great aunts agreed with when they told me the story, so I'm going to think it was real. But the people are created characters. Mm-hmm. Some things, Kathy, Roz, just, you know, some things you're going to read and go, oh, my God, yes, okay, that's, mm-hmm. it's there. I think any writer is not a happy story. The people I read are women writers, traditionally Canadian. I love women writers because I learn from them. None of those stories are really happy, right? But they have strong female protagonists who grow and develop. So they go through hell and then come out stronger and clearer of themselves, right? So I'm thinking even of Margaret Lawrence, who is also a big influence on me as a reader and writer, and Atwood, of course. Like, you know, Atwood's big for me, so. I don't think I answered your question, but that's
But that's okay. You talk about strong female characters, mm-hmm. and I look at you as a strong female character in writing on the Canadian scene in our city. You might not feel you're that way.
It's making me nervous that you said that out loud.
So I wonder, when you read the book, there's going to be one female, there's more than one that's very strong, but one female in particular that is extremely strong. Do you identify with her? When you're writing a character like that, is that the one that you personally identify with?
Are you talking about Lizzie in particular?
Yes.
I don't want to use the names in case you reveal the story.
Not wanting to drop the names. So.
But then I don't know who you're talking about, because I also think
Bridget's
really strong.
Bridget is very strong. Yeah. Bridget is the mother, and she is extremely strong.
Do not want to piss Bridget off.
Do not cross Bridget.
That's right.
So these strong female characters, do you identify with them? Is there one character there that you particularly identify with?
I think it's Lizzie. It's really hard to publish this and give it. No, I'm not giving it to you. You're buying it. Thank you. But to let her out of my life, because she's been with me on my own for 10 years, a few people have read this piece or pieces of this story, so they would know her as well a bit. But do I identify with her? Yes, I do. I feel like I was raised by fairly strict parents. I would think my sister would agree. So I feel that that's a large part of her character. And then imagining the story I know from my family, that to have the pressure of being, you know, an older daughter or having to live up to responsibilities and caring for things or being told what you are expected to do. So for example, my great-grandfather's family, there were 10 kids. There was a nun, there was a doctor. You correct me if I'm wrong, Kath. There was a nurse, there were two teachers. I mean, they all had a place, and if they didn't want to go there, I had a great uncle who was told he should be a priest, and he once told me in my 20s, I didn't, Kimmy Ruth, he said, I did not want to be a priest, so I became a teacher, an English teacher. And he went to live in Toronto. So I feel like there's a lot of conflict in terms of strength of characters, and especially inside Irish Catholic families. You mm-hmm. could ask, I'm sure any culture would have this kind of, I think Catholicism plays into this as well. I could be wrong, but I mean, I see a couple of Irish friends going, yes, yes, it's true. Mm-hmm. So if you were to ask any of these Irish friends of mine how their families worked, I think they would be similar. And if you go back further in generations, mm-hmm. they would be even more similar, especially when you consider migration in the diaspora. These people did not want to leave Ireland, and we all want to go back. We have a problem. Ask any of us, we always go back, and we're drawn to it because we love it, and they had to come here because of the famine, mm-hmm. so they had to be stronger. I feel like they might not have been that strong there, and then when they came across, they were stronger, and the following generations mm-hmm. have to deal with that. Mm-hmm. This happens now with people who move between places on the planet, so.
And this particular family, when they get to this small town, they're almost set apart. They have extra pressure on them because they are, your novel refers to them as almost the Kennedys of
yes.
the town. And so you've got religious pressure, you've got other kinds of pressure
yeah.
for them, for sure. And that makes it really interesting. But okay, I'd like to go back to Lizzie just for a moment, because that's the one that you identify with the most. Lizzie and all of your characters, her characters are flawed. They are all flawed.
They're humans, though. We're all flawed.
I know, of course. And so I say that with yes, thank you for flawed characters.
Good,
thank you.
Good.
If you identify with Lizzie, Lizzie makes a number of mistakes and bad decisions, as they all do. When you're writing, do you ever want to save your characters? Do you ever want to say, no, you can't do that? Do the characters take over? What happens?
Do I want to save them?
Well, yes, because they're making bad decisions. Yes. You're sitting there writing these bad decisions.
I mean, I do plan, and I have a sense of where the novel's going, and this took me forever, so I did plan and plan and plan and revise and revise and revise. So if I saved them, the story wouldn't be interesting. No one would read it. They'd be like, oh, they're all saved. There's no point continuing. It'd be like a bad Netflix movie where you get partway through and you're like, this is really boring. I can't continue. I'm turning it off, right? So I'm aware very much of the peaks and valleys in plot construction. My friend Sandra McIntyre, she's probably out there. She's in Wolfville, so she's watching likely. We've had great conversations on our yearly writing retreats about that tension that you need to commit to as a writer inside the plot line of your structure. If everything's going so well for a character, everybody's like, great, everything's great, there's nothing to worry about, but you need them to fall so that you can glory or, you know, applaud them in their rise again.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned at the beginning of the answer about you have plotted things out very carefully over these 10 years. You're just not running, you're just not starting to write without. I always have a vision of writers with sticky notes all over the wall or little charts. Tell us how you plot.
I do have sticky notes, but usually they're inspirational quotes from fellow writer friends and mentors. But I just get, this is so weird. So any story that I've written, whether it be a play or a short story or this novel, I'll get an image in my head of just like a movie image that I have to write down. And then if I leave it, I have to continue writing that story or it just will sit there. If I don't write it down, it disappears. Same thing with poetry. If a line comes in, I sound like I'm crazy. But a line comes in, if I don't write it down, it disappears. Mm-hmm. So I really trust the channel of the creative path. But I do, I know where it's going to end. I know where my stories are going to end. And then I have a rough plot. I'm not as good at plotting as I'm friends with Terry Fallis. And if you've read his books, he's a meticulous craftsman in terms of plot and in how he writes his books. And I've had many conversations with him about structure. Whether you're a plotter or a pantser, if you just write something by the skin, by the, you know, on your pants, or if you plot, you're a plotter. He's a plotter, I'm in between the two. Mm-hmm. So if a draft is not working, this thing's probably had maybe 20 or 30 drafts over the 10 years, so I will jettison parts. But I've also had really great mentors on this novel, so I had Larry Hill, I had Marnie Woodrow, who worked closely with me, and Matt Haiti, who's like instrumental in my work as a playwright and in this novel. But he's much too quiet. If you know Matt, you will know this, and some of his students are here, so you will have taken that course with him, or more than one course. He's been my best teacher in playwriting and in dialogue. And you know Matt, because you
And
taught
I
him.
Know Matt.
Yes.
And I agree with you, and everyone who knows Matt will agree, and he's a great mentor for you. I think you told me that when you were doing, he just said, write it like it's scenes, write your chapters like they're scenes out of a play, which was
it helped me write the beginning, because I thought, I'm so used to writing poems, how could I possibly go to a longer structure? Because a novel is so much larger. It's a country rather than a city.
I just want to go back to something you said that just caught me. When you said, I have an image, I start from an image sometimes, that just a vision. That's exactly what Anne Marie MacDonald answered to that question.
I love her.
She started, she didn't know what her novel was going to be with Fane, but she started with an image of a little girl on the moors and she didn't know where it was going to go. Will you share with us your image?
The first
if you had
image?
One. Well, just that, the first thing that started you thinking, I need to write about this.
Oh, well, I've shown it to you, I think. It's a photo that I have of my grandparents and my great aunt. And not they're
this one. Oh, not that one.
No, I'm telling them that, but this is another one. Oh. So the one that I look at is the three of them on a picnic near Lake Ramsey, and his face is sort of, you probably, if you're in my family, you guys over there, you all have seen this. His face is kind of obscured by a pine bough, and the two sisters are sitting there, and he looks mysterious. So I just started thinking, oh, and then the story came, and I thought, this is too good. This is one of my favorite photos of my grandmother. It's actually taken from when she went across on her honeymoon to England. So she and my grandfather were married on coronation day. I hope I'm right, Kathy, because she used to always tell me May 12th, 1937. She was very proud of that. And so there was a picture of them on the ship, and this is where that's from. They dress so well. That's why I often refer to this family as the Kennedys, because one of my favorite Kelly family photos, you all will know it, is the 10 of them in the backyard at Kingsmount, and they're all so beautifully turned out. They dressed so well back in the 40s, right? Like, even if they didn't have a lot of money, everything matched. They had hats and purses and shoes and belts and Eaton's catalog pieces.
And that's one of the first things that we see here is Bridget telling each of the girls what color, what they have to wear, what color the bow is in their hair, you know, all of that. I was surprised in the honeymoon section of this book that they went to England. And I thought, why didn't they go to Ireland? But this is part of where your family, where this honeymoon was in your, is that why it's England? That it was?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. The other thing that surprised me, not only getting to England, you're in a laugh.
I'm afraid because you told me not to give away things. And
no, I never said who got
I'm
married.
I'm like, you're totally going to, I'm
afraid
said now what to say.
I never said who, I just said it surprised me that there was a honeymoon in England and not Ireland. And it surprised me that we went to Finland in the book. Do you want to mention about why we end up in Finland at all? Or
so this is part of the family story. In my family, my grandfather went to Finland to work at a nickel mine in Petsamo. And what my mother told me, now every sibling that my mother had would have a different story. My Aunt Kathy is the only sibling left, so I will just tell you what my mother told me, which was that he was going there to work in a nickel mine at the cusp of the winter war in Finland. So Lisa Kovala is here. Thanks for all the help with the winter war research, Lisa. And he went there because he was quite vocal about mining rights for the miners at the Garson mine. And the company was not happy. They sort of demoted him and then sent him, one of his options was to go off to Finland. That's not a great place to go just before the winter war, because you're talking about the Soviets, and if you travel there now, Petsamo, where they went, is actually now part of Russia. So if you go to Tallinn, it's in Estonia, but there are elements of Russian architecture there. So I've gone off track again. I tend to do this.
No, but I love the fact that she's included all of this history in the book. It was kind of unexpected. I thought we were going to be staying in one small town and maybe getting to Sudbury on occasion, but I didn't imagine going to England. I didn't imagine going to Finland, and it was a wonderful surprise.
Oh,
it was
good.
Great. How about we hear a little bit of a reading?
Okay. I thought I would read you two little pieces. It's so weird to me. I was saying to Judy back there that I'm used to reading poetry, so this is bizarre. I'll read you the prologue, which is the thing that I didn't initially have, and then one of my mentors said, you need a hook, so this is the hook. In her own mind, she questioned what had happened that day. It was all a blur. Memory was like that. There had been a long walk through the northern woods, pushing past the limbs of birches and white pines, stepping over bits of moss, rocks, and blueberry bushes. There had been a rush of blood to her head so that she could hear the sound of her own heart beating too loudly inside her skull. A flash of heat had swept up her body from belly to breasts to the spread of her shoulders and up her neck. A dizziness, a rush, a fainting. Had it happened by mistake when she had fallen? Had she somehow neglected to take proper care of herself and her unborn child? Or, she wondered, had she lost her mind in the time of Michael's having left her alone? She knew, been out by herself when she ought not to have been, by accident or on purpose? one side or the other, so many stories. There were the stories that people told you and the ones you told yourself to make yourself feel better. Somewhere in the middle, there was the truth. She could hear the train, its whistle echoed, calling out and reminding her of thunder, how a storm could rumble in the distance, and then how it would creep across the landscape. That train would carry rough nickel ore from the north, the south, down to Toronto. She wished she had taken a train years ago, before she had been trapped here on the shore of Mud Lake, on the edge of a mining town. If she could go back, she knew now, she might have chosen a different path, another story, maybe even another man. That's a hook.
Da, 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 da.
Right? That's a hook. So that was a, yeah.
You decided to write a prologue and an epilogue.
Yes, I can't read the epilogue.
No.
Give away the story entirely.
No. But just why did you make that decision? Why didn't you start writing a chapter one?
Because I see this as a trilogy, but I mean, I'm only partway through the second book, which is Anne's story. Part of that set down in southwestern Ontario, which is like my second home, Windsor and Kingsville. So I'm not sure. The story is, in and of itself, its own story, but it leaves it open to possibilities if I choose to go mm-hmm. there. But my next novel is not historic at all.
The next novel. We'll be back here again. What? I hope it's not 10 years until we're back here again.
No, it's almost done.
Oh, good.
I'm getting faster. As I practice writing over the decades, I'll be not 60, I hope.
What was it like to choose the point of view that you were going to be writing from? You chose a third-person point of view. You could have told the story maybe from Lizzie's. Why did you choose that?
Point of view is really hard when you're writing because I have friends who write a whole novel. One of my friends has written a whole novel in one point of view, narrative, and then she just said to me, I'm going to take it apart this summer and just rewrite it from third. And I thought, are you nuts? Because that means you have to completely reshift structure, voice, everything, even occurrences inside. I'm too lazy to do that. So I think first person does draw a reader in because it's almost like eavesdropping, but I wanted to give a sense of the variety of people and the different kinds of mm-hmm. humans that there mm-hmm. are inside families and communities.
Mm-hmm. And I wondered too, when you were writing, she writes, there is a main character that's a male, clearly.
And Michael?
Is that his name?
Yeah.
Michael is the main character. And there are a couple of phrases where in the book they say, I don't know how a man thinks. I have no idea how a man thinks. Did you have any more difficulty writing a Michael than a Lizzie or an Anne or anybody else, the male character?
No, I didn't, and that's kind of interesting because I think of Carol Shields, who wrote Larry's Party. If you've read Larry's Party, it's all from the point of view of a man. Or Roddy Doyle, who wrote The Woman Who Walked Into Doors, and then Paula Spencer. So, and then there's Wally Lamb has a book called She's Come Undone. So there are some really great books there, but you can hear, I can hear people going, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I guess if we only wrote our gender, it could be really difficult and limiting. I enjoyed writing Michael because he's kind of not always pristine.
Michael can be. Michael is...
she's trying to find the word. I have
Hollywood
a word.
Handsome.
I have a
and
different
a cad.
Word.
At one end, Hollywood handsome, wonderful. At the other end, a bit of a cad sometimes.
Cad's so a kind
I think
word.
You've done. I think you've done a wonderful job writing that.
He's a player.
That male character. He's a player. You have a label in Sudbury. We think of you as a poet. We have thought of you as a poet for years. I mean, you were a poet laureate. You've written 5 books at least of poetry.
Yeah.
But you are indeed a writer.
Yeah.
You are not a poet. You write short stories. You write plays. You are a writer. But how has being a poet impacted this writing of this novel?
A lot of people ask me this, but I feel like when you read it, you will see I'm a poet. It's fairly clear when I read that little piece. It's poetic prose. Everything I write that's not poetry straightforwardly is poetic in stylings. So my plays, Matt's done dramaturgy on them. Catherine Banks has done dramaturgy, and both have said, oh, it's really poetic. You have lots of imagery and metaphor. You build these ribbons of metaphor through, and I don't even know I'm doing it. It's like breathing. So it's there in my plays, it's there in my creative nonfiction. It's the way I think and the way I am. It makes it hard to be in the world today as that kind of person.
But it makes the reading very rich. I really enjoyed the imagery so much. You're going to enjoy it immensely. It will impact you. Sometimes if I can't remember the scene, I remember the image where there is a leaf falling from a tree, trying to hang on to a tree. It's just a leaf in the breeze trying to hang on to the tree, and then finally the wind takes it away and it falls to the ground, and it just says so much.
Mm-hmm. There it's going to make me cry.
But there are so many beautiful things that I think you're going to enjoy, and I wondered if that comes from the poetry or just comes from the way you approach writing, period, and in general.
I think it does come from the poetry. I write a lot of ekphrastic poetry based on what I see visually in art. Mm-hmm. So I'll write lots of poetry based on women artists. But I think it's just that I take a lot of time and care and craft. And I don't have a master's in creative writing. I've done some workshops over different summers with different writers that I admire. And they've just helped me raise my own bar. And so I choose mentors who make me get stronger as a craftsperson, and I don't rip things off quickly. I've never rushed to publish, which is probably why this is like taken 10 years.
Well, I'm glad your mentors worked hard with you.
They're really great humans.
It's paid off,
yeah,
for us as readers. I have to ask you this question. It may be quite uncomfortable, but you write about
whiskey
sex. You write about sex.
Because it happens.
And she writes about death.
Because it also happens?
Yes. The scene about death is so impactful. Mm-hmm. Is it harder to write about sex or death? I just thought she must have gone back over and over and over these sections. And,
like,
and
I have two aunts like in my front two rows, like, right here.
I just wanted to compliment you on the death one.
No,
sure.
I can speak to both. I think if you're going to write sex, you better write it well, or it's garbage. So, you know, I think if you're going to write sex, not erotica, but, you know, sex scenes, it better have a purpose and it better be done properly and crafted carefully. Mm-hmm. Better have a reason for being there. Mm-hmm. And I just read an article by a Canadian writer who talked about this, that you need to make sure that it was almost like if you're going to use profanity, you don't just, if I'm going to make a curry, I don't put in too much curry powder or I've ruined it. So the same thing would be with where you create these various scenes, which are more intimate, and you have to be careful in how you write them, because some of those scenes tilt over into something darker in the novel. Mm-hmm. That was harder to write. So sex scenes were easy. The darker parts were harder. Mm-hmm. This death scene was really hard, and I can't say much about it because you haven't read it yet, but it was based on someone.
Oh, the thing I wondered about, because it's so powerfully written, were you crying when you were writing that? Did it, or were you able to stand outside it and know what you had to do?
It was based on someone I taught in my first 3 years of teaching, so yeah. I didn't cry, but it was very, it's there.
Oh, it's so moving. It's just a wonderful section. It's just so moving. We do have to get to the Q&A if you do have a question, but one last thing.
Any sex questions. She's already done it.
There are so many surprising things, and I was just shocked at the in the book when you actually, she names streets in Sudbury all the time. We go, you know, go down Beach Street, and then you go down this street. Mm-hmm. But when we get to King's Mount.
I know, you're really freaked out about this.
And Wembley, I am.
Please don't go to these houses.
She will give you the address.
Stop,
of the
just
house.
Don't go to the houses.
I just thought, I have to drive there right now, which I haven't
probably
done.
Won't,
I have not.
They probably won't read this, so it's fine.
But the reason you were specific about the streets and the houses, again, is just a reflection on family. It's a springboard from family.
One is my grandmother's house, and there are scenes written in the novel based on that house, which was built by the Evans family, and they were a lumber family. That's what my grandmother told me.
Yeah, that was so neat to have the Evans family mm-hmm. building the house.
Kathy, I don't know if you heard that story or not. See? And that's her daughter, but I heard it from Graham Ennis, so I'm going to trust it. And then my great aunt's house, my great grandfather's house, was on King's Mount, mm-hmm. block away. Mm-hmm. So far, but not far.
Can you tell that this book is waiting for you to discover and to go through it? Do not start it tonight. You will stay up
start
far too
tonight.
Late.
Start
you
it
will,
tonight.
You will stay up way too late, I warn you. It's now time for our Q&A. Heather, you have a microphone. We can't see you at all. If you have a question, will you please raise your hand and Heather will come over with the microphone. There we have a first question flashing up there.
So nervous now.
Kim, I just want to know, do you dream about your characters that you write?
Is this you, Karen?
Yes, it is.
Do you dream about the characters that you write?
Like in sleep?
Yeah.
Sometimes, I mean, I will wake up with ideas for stories, so I think possibly some of the stories that I've written have come from that in-between place between sleeping and waking, but they're mostly haunting me through the daytime hours, like, I don't know. People who write creatively, and I know there are loads of writers in this crowd, will be like, I can see your faces partially in the blinding light. But they kind of just walk with me. That's why it's hard when you have to publish. It's hard to publish. When I first finished the first draft, which is not this draft, I cried. So I don't know. I feel like they're part of who I am. Hmm. They're very real people to me.
Next question.
Maybe no one has any questions. That's okay, too.
We have a question right up here, Heather. Why are you hoping no one has questions?
Well, I'm just saying it. Your sex and death one makes me nervous now.
I just want to know if Michael the player is based on a true person.
Who is that? Is that Tammy?
Is Michael based on a true person?
Let's say I've had very bad experiences with men. Historically, so I've rolled a number of them in there. But just like any woman who's had an experience with someone who's dishonest mm-hmm. and who creates the illusion of not being dishonest and then upends your safety and trust, you know, mm-hmm. that kind of thing happening is there.
He's a compilation of many.
I think women will relate to it. I don't know what it's like for men, so I'm not going to
go women, there. You will relate. You will relate.
And it's available for book clubs. I'm happy to come to book
it's
clubs.
It's perfect for a book club.
With wine.
We have another question right up here.
I have the microphone here. And I'm just...
Is that Andrea?
Yes, yes, it is.
I
actually.
Thought you weren't... These are all my Marymount people. Right? Thank you for coming. They're my regals.
But I'm used to reading your poetry, and I'm used to reading, like, even short stories from you. But so... You keep calling this novel fiction,
yeah.
But as I'm listening to you, I feel like it's historical fiction.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, so when I read it, I will be that much more enlightened to the life of what happened, you know, in the past, correct?
I hope so. I did a lot of research.
Awesome.
So I hope so.
I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
But I should clarify that, yeah, it's historical fiction. Somebody said, oh, maybe it's a romance. That was Marcus Schwabi, and he said to me before my interview.
That interview the other night, or the other morning, yeah. And I was like, Marcus, just stop. Like, you sounded brilliant, and I just wanted him to stop talking.
Oh. No, that was a good interview, but he said, is it just a romance? And I said, no, it's historical fiction. I often feel now the genre of historical fiction, Rosanna can, you know, is deferred in can lit to romance historical fiction. This is not a happy story. So there are parts of romance in here, but mm-hmm. life is not always romantic, so it's realistic. And then, yeah, I did a lot of research, thanks to Lisa Kovala, and the local, I want to say, Jessica, it's Kristen Bertrand.
That's right.
She's our local Sudbury history librarian at the Sudbury Public Library, so I spent time with her researching Creighton, and then Lisa Kovala got me started on researching the Winter War. So those two, I thought to myself, why are you doing this to yourself? Really, you could have written a simpler story. So the research had to be right. I had to research the kind of cologne he would wear for what I imagined I would find attractive, so that was hard.
And I, when I read it, I appreciate all of that research, because I thought about that when I was reading it.
Yeah.
It is clear that it's there. We have another question.
Hi, Kim.
Hi, Anna.
I'm wondering, do you do anything between the projects you're working on to keep your skills sharp?
My skills sharp?
Yeah, for exercise as opposed to work.
Like work, writing work?
Yeah, or anything. Hmm.
How I keep my skills sharp when I'm not writing? I read every day, so I mostly try to read Canadian literature. Because I'm involved so heavily in the Writers Union, and I'm aware of writers across Canada, and just that, being involved with TWC, as it's called, the Writers Union of Canada is TWC, I'm really grateful for my involvement in that organization and learning so much about writers across Canada. So I've read a lot of colleagues' work that I might not have read before having become so involved in TWC. And I take courses. So I, if you're a poet, like my friend Yvonne Blomer was Poet Laureate of Victoria when I was Poet Laureate here, and in recent years she's offered, through the pandemic, a lot of offerings came up for writers online, so you could pay and work with a writer. So I will often do a series of evening classes that she runs in BC on Sunday nights. I'm very tired Monday morning. And then I'll take a series of classes with her, or I've worked with Catherine Banks through Sage Hill, and I worked with Ken Babstock for poetry through Sage Hill, and Tannis McDonald for creative nonfiction, Lawrence Hill at Banff, and then two mentors in Scotland, so John Glenday and Jen Hadfield. There's loads more. Marnie Woodrow is really important to me. Gosh, there's loads I'm probably missing. But I just try to read every day, and I write every day. I don't believe in writer's block. I just feel like if I get blocked on one project, I have like three different things going right now. So I'm almost finished a novel draft. I'm working on a collection of short creative nonfiction essays, and then I'm editing my final draft of my poems, which are coming out in the spring, the bee ones, because you've got bees at home. And then there's like another novel starting in my head. So if I get blocked on one, I move to the next. So if I feel like I'm rusty in one craft, I'll try to connect with fellow writers. I have really great writing groups. So I have my creative nonfiction group. I'm not going to name them, but they know who they are, and they're probably watching. And then a group of writers from my Banff session with Larry, and then the great Canadian women poets of the Electronic Garret. We write a poem a day every April for National Poetry Month, and then now we're the Wild Iris. So all of these women and men are great friends and colleagues, and they raise my bar. They are my teachers as colleagues in workshopping.
How do you have time to have a job? Really, think of all you're doing. My goodness, that's overwhelming.
I love teaching kids, though.
Me too.
We teach at a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
One last question. Anyone burning that one question you didn't get to ask? Oh, it's right here.
Yes, Kim, what do you find the most rewarding about writing fiction and the most challenging?
Well, I've written short fiction forever, so I came to short fiction really quite simply. I didn't have a hard time with it. I guess the challenge in my head was jumping over my own misconstrued notion that I couldn't write something longer. So, I have to thank Larry Hill for that, because he was just constantly... and Matt, because they were both telling me, and Marnie, those three are really key to this, and Timothy Finley, all those four, because they taught me that I have to not get overwhelmed by the size of it, to focus on each little piece as a little piece unto itself, and that's a gem, and so you polish that gem not to the point where you don't write forward, but that you're just, oh, that was a nice chapter. I wrote a nice scene of 2 pages. It may not make the final cut, but I mean, I don't, what do you think? Yes, that's a better way of saying what I was trying to say, yeah. Because the inner critic is my worst person. The voice inside my head is not my friend. Most days of the week, the people I work with will know this too.
We have come to the end of the question and answer period. We have come to the end of the discussion period. Can you feel the love, Kim Fahner? Can you feel it? So what we're going to do is have a little more music,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
And then we're going to set up a table right here so that those of you who wish to get your book signed and buy the books for Christmas and Valentine's Day and all of the, you know, for the rest of the year and get them all signed, you can get a drink downstairs. Please get a drink. You can either drink it downstairs or come back up and drink it here and then wait so you don't have to stand in line too long. And then we'll have the line start this side and it'll come to here and then walk out that way, but please feel that you do not have to rush away.
No, I'll be here.
You'll be here till the cows come
home.
Well,
I might tip over.
So now it's time for more music.
I do. I wasn't going to. Well, I was, I don't know. I feel like we're, I don't want to drag on too long.
Read it.
Oh, okay.
Which one?
Okay. What time is it, though? I don't want to drag you guys.
It's Pat's, 10 after 8.
Pat's now going to sit there and I'll read you a little excerpt from Lizzie in the Church in Creighton because I feel like it's suited to this place. If you're Catholic, and some of you are and some of you aren't, but those of you who are Catholic will know what it's like to sit in Mass when you're 8. It's pretty much hell. And so my grandma would keep us in check by pulling like Kleenexes out of her bra, her cardigan sleeves, and then also she had like a stash of Lifesavers, peppermint. And so, you know, you had to eat the host, and if you ate the host, you got a Lifesaver. Like, I don't know. You had to behave because Jesus was there too. But anyway, this is kind of what I think about remembering that time. So Lizzie's having to go to church there with the family, and she fancies Michael, but Anne's kind of been dating him and courting him, I guess. This is her. So once inside the church, Lizzie slipped into her daydreaming. It happened every time. There was simply no stopping it. Mrs. Taylor's hat was slate gray, the color of the wet rock at the mine. It was a depressing color, Lizzie thought to herself, as she listened to Father Regan drone on and on about salvation and helping one's neighbors. It was the same damn thing every Sunday. She resented having to be here, being forced to listen to him, and she was too easily distracted by the feathered quill that sprouted rebelliously from Mrs. Taylor's hat. She sighed too loudly, and she immediately felt her mother's eyes on her, disdainful and disparaging. Lizzie rolled her eyes heavenwards, looking up at the rafters of the ceiling, wishing she could just hop up there and bounce away somewhere. In her head, in her imagination, she drifted from rafter to rafter like a blown-up balloon, and then out the door that must have somehow been left ajar. Then from there, well, she might have gone anywhere. She thought of Europe mostly and found herself wondering how she could ever manage to visit there. How would the daughter of a merchant in a simple mining town ever make it south to Toronto, east to Montreal, and then down the St. Lawrence in some sort of ship? Lizzie shut her eyes, squeezing the lids tightly together so that there was a zigzaggy line across what had been her field of vision. She imagined someone opening the church's main door, and then she could see herself bouncing down the front wooden steps, vaulting over the various heaps of rock and gravel, a barren landscape to be sure. And then right on down the road, out past Lively and Coppercliff, and beyond it to Sudbury, and maybe even on northward, on towards North Bay, Pembroke, and finally Ottawa. Phew, that would be a trip of some dimension. Where would she go from there? Perhaps in a more ladylike fashion, she would deflate and squish herself back into the form of a respectable young lady. She would have to wear that boring navy draped dress with the pearls, so that she would be in complete disguise as she moved on to Montreal and boarded a ship bound for Ireland, England. She might, she imagined, stop off in Ireland just to see if any of her relatives were still living. Most had come here, so she doubted there would be many people left to visit after all these years. Lizzie had heard her father speak of Limerick and of Bunratty Castle, where some governess of an ancestor had run off with a gardener, not letting the grass grow under their feet. No point thinking about that, though. It was all so done and gone. You might as well fall down a mine shaft, like Alice in Wonderland or something just as fanciful. Thanks.
Thank you. Do you see what's waiting for you? Beautiful. Thank you. All right. Time to sing.
Oh, yeah.
So I was in Nova Scotia this year, and one of my mom's favorite singers was Rita McNeil. Thinking about a mining town song, and I went to see Dear Rita. It was a show at the Neptune, and I was surrounded by people from Cape Breton who cried as much as me that night because they played Rita songs, and my mom's favorite songs were there. So we thought we would sing Working Man for you, and if you know the chorus, you might know it, so you can sing along. I never know how to start this, so... It's a working man I am, and I've been down underground. And I swear to God, if I ever see the sun, or for any length of time, I can hold it in my mind. I never again will go down underground. At the age of 16 years, oh, he quarrels with his peers, who vowed they'd never see another one. In the dark recess of the mines, where you wait before your time, and the coal dust lies heavy on your lungs, it's a working man I am, and I've been down underground, and I swear to God, if I ever see the sun, or for any length of time, I can hold it in my mind. I never again will go down underground. At the age of 64, oh, he'll greet you at the door, and he'll gently lead you by the arm. Through the dark recess of the mines, oh, he'll take you back in time. Then he'll tell you of the hardships that were had. It's a working man I am, and I've been down underground, and I swear to God, if I ever see the sun, or for any length of time, I can hold it in my mind. I never again will go down underground. I never again will go down underground. We're going to do the parting glass, which I usually do at every launch I've ever done, because it's in Ireland, they'll do this song at the end of the night in pubs, It's also done at funerals. So to, you know, go against that deadly ending, we're going to have Carly do a little, what's it called again?
Joy Be With You.
Joy Be With You at the end of the sad song. So you go with the going song, but you have the joy to go with the going song. In Ireland, when you go away, you say Slána Waala. Do you know that, Pat?
I
means
do.
Safe home. So I guess I would just say officially then before we sing this that we wish you a safe home when it's time afterwards.
Or you
afterwards.
Can do Slán go fóill.
Okay, well.
See you later.
Yeah. All right, go with the Gaelic. He's so much more fluent, but I know how to use the bathroom, like, so. Okay, we're ready?
Yeah.
All the money that e'er I had, I spent it in good company. And all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. Of all the comrades that e'er I had, they are sorry for my going away. And all the sweethearts that e'er I had, they would wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and softly call. Good night and joy be with you all. A man may drink and not be drunk. A man may fight and not be slain. A man may court a pretty girl and perhaps be welcome back again. But since it has so ordered be, by time to rise and a time to fall, come fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. So fill to me the parting glass and drink a health of air befalls. Come fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. I'm make sure you get drinks, and then I'm going to set up here. We can sign. Oh, you're already ready to go, but I need more water.
That was good.